We have one gentleman to thank for our salvation. He flies that flag. We have many, many men and women who saved us from tyranny and destruction, and they fall under that flag. And so this morning, if you have served our country in that capacity, would you stand so we can honor you? Anyone? Everyone? Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. There are a lot of things we must do. Doctors tell us that we should eat a good breakfast, right? We must eat a good breakfast. The highway department tells us we must drive on the right-hand side of the road. But then there are times when I have trouble with the word must. We must, for instance, do this, or we must, for instance, do that. I remember just a couple of weeks ago coming back into the house, and I had bought a brand new rifle, and I was thinking about whether I must tell Sherry or not. But I knew she'd understand because she loved me so much, and especially if I presented the purchase to her in the right way, correctly, right? And she taught me how to do this 45, 46 years ago, and here's what you do. I learned it from here. She has a shoe rack at home that sits at the end of a 10 by 6 foot closet. I get this little closet over here. And the shoe rack holds 60 pairs of shoes. And it's full. And along the floor, there's another, what, two dozen? So, yeah, I learned, exactly. Anyway, so I present my purchases to her now like she presents them to me. So I came in the house with this brand new rifle, and she said, well, guys, pay attention, because this is a game changer. This really is. I came home with a brand new rifle, and she said to me, she said, you bought a brand new rifle? And I said, yes, but you'll never believe what happened. The rifle was priced at $2,400, but it had a sticker on it for $400. $400 savings right off the top. Then I bartered with the guy, and he brought it down another $300. I saved $700 today. You're not going to believe it, and it's incredible, and that's exactly what happened.
Thank you, Ray.
You're welcome. And even now, I can picture her sweet face looking at me and so proud. Oh, you're such a good husband. That is so, yeah, that was so nice, you know. And I said, you must be really, really proud of me. Well, maybe that was a little bit of embellishment. But anyway, that was a little help for my brothers and sisters this morning. So there's things you must do and things that maybe you, well, there's things you must do. And if we look at John 3:7, Jesus is talking to Nicodemus. And here's what Jesus says. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. George Whitefield was an early American colonial pastor, and he was one of the founders of the evangelical movement way back in the early 1700s. And he was known for telling his people all of the time, you must be born again. Hi, how are you, George? Good, you must be born again. He was known for it. And people started to ask him, why do you always tell us we must be born again? And he said, because you must be born again. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. You must be born again. And I think the reason for this, reason he was so adamant about this was the fact that our journey to the cross, it isn't like an overhaul. You know, like we're in our house right now, we're getting ready to sell it, so we're overhauling a few things. We're putting in some new floors here and doing some, well, we're not, Neil is. Thank you, Neil. But we're putting in some new floors, we're doing a few things into the house to kind of overhaul it. Well, being born again isn't overhauling me. It's not regenerating me. It's not reorganizing me, and it's not improving me. Being born again is actually meaning that the old man and the old woman is completely dead. Now, why is that so important? Because we were born sinners. right? We were born sinners. So what kind of a life would we have to be born just to die? We're born in 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, maybe 100 years later, we just die, and where do we go? Life would have absolutely no meaning. And so Jesus had to come to earth and save us with his work on the cross so that our lives would mean something. We're a completely new man and woman when we're born again. And Jesus, Jesus doesn't see any of our sin. We can stand in God's presence. Did you know that? In heaven, we'll stand in God's presence and no sin can be in his presence. And so if we can stand in his presence when we're in heaven, that means we're what? Sinless. Not only are we sinless, not only did the blood of Christ cover and bury that sin, God himself said, I chose to forget it. I chose a lot of things, but there's some things I can't forget. But he can, he's God. And Jesus here is talking to, I think I'm stuck in the chair. Jesus here is talking to Nicodemus. You know, when he said, you must be born again. And this is an interesting meeting because Nicodemus was a Pharisee. Remember him? He was a Pharisee. And he went by the book, which means he followed every law there was. He followed the law carefully. He read the Bible. He followed each and every law as well as he could. And then he had scribes that worked with the Pharisees. You had Pharisees and you had scribes. And the scribes would read the laws and then make new laws. Yeah. Kind of tweak them a little bit, you know, where you could do this and you couldn't do this and you couldn't do that. And one of the laws the scribes came up with was that you could not tie a permanent knot. You can't make this up, so Google it. You cannot tie a permanent knot on the Sabbath. And so that was a problem. It was a problem for a lot of folks. It was a problem specifically maybe for people with boats in the shipping industry, where the boat would sail in on the Sabbath and you couldn't tie it up to the pier. Or maybe you had an animal and you couldn't tie it up. But anyway, you could not tie a knot. But the scribe said, but wait a minute. It does say here, we believe it says here, that a lady can tie her girdle. True story. True story. So, how do we get around it? We get a girdle. We tie it to the boat, we tie it to the pier. And we're done. You can't make this stuff up. I mean, you really, really can't. And what this was proving to them was you cannot save yourself. There's just no way. Nicodemus should have known you can't save yourself. You need a savior because nobody could keep all those laws. It was impossible to keep all those laws. I can't even keep some of the Ten Commandments. And I only had 10 that I had to worry about. Which reminds me of a pastor who told me the story. No one can be saved. And this reminds me of the story that this pastor told me. You know, we think we're good, but he said that there was two men discussing, and one man said, a common man can't become a gentleman. And the other man said, well, a common man can become a gentleman. And he said, I'll prove it to you. He said, a common man can become a gentleman, watch this. And he whistled. And the cat got up, ran into the kitchen, grabbed a bag on the shelf that had a sandwich in it, and brought it back to him and placed it by his feet. And he goes, now that's a gentleman. The other guy says, well, hold on, wait a minute. And he went into the other room and he opened up the bird cage and let off 4 birds. And instantly the cat wasn't a gentleman anymore and started going after the birds. Right? It's true. It's true. You can be a gentleman for a while, but you need the Holy Spirit to stay that way. Right? We're all sinners. That's our nature to sin. That's it. Jesus is speaking to Nicodemus, and this conversation is broken down into two parts, and this is really, really important. First, they spoke face-to-face, okay? They had a conversation face-to-face, and they were talking about this problem. Secondly, this conversation turned into a man-to-man conversation. And then in the next part of this chapter, it turned into a heart-to-heart conversation. And that's what we have to do with each other. That's what we have to do with our loved ones. Look at this. John 3:1-3. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night, Nick at night, and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him. And Jesus answered and said to him, "Most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Now, the first part of the again, let me look at this. "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God," right? "For no one can do these signs that you do unless" what? "God is with him." What would you have done if you were Jesus there? I might have gone, "Well, thank you. Of course I am. Thanks for the accolades. I am a teacher come from God." Right? What did he say? He threw all of that away. He looked at a man to man and said, "But you must be born again." He got right to the point. No wishy-washy, no messing around. Right to the point. "You must be born again. Most assuredly, I say to you," he said, "unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." So here we are, and we come to those that we know. We come to our family members, and we come to our friends, and we butter them up, and we say, "You know, I really love you." Now, you've all done this. "I really like you. You're a good friend of mine. You're a relative. You're whoever you are. I'd like to have you come to our church. I really would. I'd like you." You know, our pastor, he preaches and teaches right from the Bible. He's a little crazy, but he preaches and teaches right from the Bible. The praise team and the choir, they do a marvelous job. They sing great music that lifts us up. The people are just fantastic. You'll love everybody in the church. And what do they say? "Yeah, thanks for the invite. It's okay. I'd like to go, but you know, I've kind of read my Bible, and you know, I get some of it, and I don't know, I'm kind of on the fence. Do I believe or not believe? And you know, what's going on? And I've been to a lot of different churches. I tell you what. Talk to me again, maybe in a couple of weeks or so. I'll go to church with you, right? Yeah. What would happen if you said, "You must be born again. You have to come to church with me because you must be born again." There's no argument. There's no fighting. You must be born again. You have to make that choice now because I love you. I love you and I want what's best for you. And guess what? If that's the case, then you both have something to lose, don't you? You really do. Were you a bit pushy? Were you a bit aggressive? Absolutely. You have to go to church with me because you must be born again. Is their salvation worth it? If you love them, it is. They can't hear you because they're blinded. They have no sight, no hearing, no sense of Jesus. They're blinded by Satan, and they need to be told. Just like Sherry tells me, "Don't ever buy another rifle." But I got the message. I got the message, and they need the message. If you were in a car and you were driving and it was going over the cliff, would you just jump out of the car and let it go with some of the passenger in it? No. You'd say, "You must jump out of the car now." What's the difference? I mean, really, seriously, what's the difference? I remember my first introduction to a pastor, Jim. He was a great guy. He is a great guy. I don't know, 30, 40 years ago? 40 years ago. He started a small group in our house, and guess what? We started a church from that small group. But I was a smart guy, and I fought him all the way. He came to the house, and we'd go fishing. We'd go doing a lot of different things together, but I didn't believe in God. And if he wanted to spout all that stuff in my house and everybody's happy about it, that was fine. But I'd always ask him questions just to try to trip him a little bit, you know. I pretty much disagree with everything is what I'm trying to tell you. And after a while, it was quite a while, but after a while one day I started in on that like that on him, and you know what he said? He said, "No, stop." And that took me by surprise. What do you mean, stop? He said, "I have told you everything you need to know to save yourself. We've talked about it for months. You've sat in my studies for months. You've come to the church for months where I work. You've done all this, blah, 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 blah. You have enough information to either kill yourself or save yourself. You must be born again." Right? It comes a time when people have to make that choice. He didn't say you must be born again, but he told me about a story. Remember the story about the snake on the brass pole? in the Old Testament where the snake was on a brass pole and the people had sinned against God. And so the snakes were coming out and biting them. And so the only way they could save themselves was to look up on the snake, to see the snake. And when they looked up on the snake, they saw the snake, and the snakes wouldn't bite them. And what he was doing was making the people lift their eyes to heaven. And so basically all we have to do is lift our eyes to heaven. I got that from that snake story. And if I lift my eyes to heaven, the snakes will stop biting me. Finally, Jesus said to Nicodemus, here he spoke heart to heart. John 3:4, Nicodemus said to him, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? And Jesus answered, most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. Nicodemus should have known all of this, right? The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but cannot tell where it comes from and where it goes. So is everyone who is born of the Spirit. Now, you and I meeting that might go, what? What is he talking about, the wind? What is he talking about? But you ought to remember who Nicodemus was. Nicodemus was Nicodemus, and we know in the Old Testament, whenever they talked about the wind, it was basically the Spirit of God. So when he said the wind blows here and there, and who knows where it's going to go, Nicodemus knew automatically he was talking about the Spirit of God. And he had to give him credit because he asked Jesus a question. Nicodemus said this, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? He didn't look at Jesus and say, you are nuts. You're crazy. What are you talking about? Respectfully talking man to man, face to face, and heart to heart, he said, how can this happen? How can this be? He was open to the conversation. He was open to knowing what was going on. And that's why. Why would he do that? Because Jesus loved him. He knew Jesus loved him. He knew Jesus cared for him. He knew Jesus was taking the time to explain these things to him, and he was speaking to him heart to heart. When you do that to your neighbors, your family, and your friends, they'll respect you. They'll respect you. You might have to say, you must be born again, and I'm not going to give up on you because I love you, but they'll respect you. So speak the word of Christ boldly. Speak it with conviction and speak it right out. Speak it through your hearts. That's what people need because that's what this is all about. Look at us here. We love one another. We know one another. We're a family here. And that's that love that has brought us together. And why wouldn't it bring your neighbors or your friends or anybody else you know? Why wouldn't it work? I think the last reason that Nicodemus looked at Jesus and kind of understood what was going on was because he saw God in him. And that's something that we can do too, can't we? What happens when we evangelize and talk to people and tell them you must be born again? Who should they be seeing? Who is it aggrandizing? Us or him? They should see Jesus in us. They saw God in Jesus, then we should have Jesus be seen in us when we go out. But the important thing is here is there's no ifs, ands, and buts. You must be born again. And if you love somebody and if you truly care for somebody, you won't give up until the last day. You will not give up until the last second, the last minute of the last day. That's our job. That's our job to do. It's not too hard to say to somebody, listen, I really love you and I have a few things to say. Let's go have a coffee. It's not too hard. Can you do that? Witness to them? Hold them in your arms and tell them? That's your job for this week. Find some folks that don't know Jesus and think to yourself, I must bring Jesus into their life. Amen?